Boa tarde a todos, bom pomeriggio.
Good afternoon and welcome. Today we have many guests, Reverend Sister Samuela Maria Rigon, Superior General of the Sisters, Franciscan Sisters of the Sorrowful Mother. She holds a doctorate from the Institute of Psychology at the Gregorian University, where she has studied and has been teaching for several years. She also carries out other duties in her congregation, where she was appointed Superior General. Sister Samuela Rigon is a psychologist and lecturer at the Faculty of Theology of the Pontifical Antonianum University, a member of the Presidency Council of USMI. Also with us, we have Cardinal Charles Mangbo, Archbishop of Yangon, President of the Federation of Asian Bishops Conference, member of the Ordinary Council. He was born in Mandalay in his metropolitan of Yangon since 2003. He was created a cardinal by Pope Francis in February 2015. He is a member of the Dicastery for Institutes of Consecrated Life and Societies of Apostolic Life for Divine Worship and the Discipline of Sacraments. He is also a member of our Dicastery for Communication and president of the Episcopal Conference of Myanmar. We also have the pleasure of having with us Cardinal Gérald Cyprien Lacroix, Archbishop of Quebec. He's also a member of the Ordinary Council, too. He was born in the Archdiocese of Quebec. In 2009, he was appointed Auxiliary Bishop, and in 2011, Archbishop of Quebec. The Pope created him a cardinal in the consistory of February 2014. And he was also appointed on that occasion a member of the Dicastery for Institutes of Consecrated Life and Societies of Apostolic Life and the then Pontifical Councils for Interreligious Dialogue and Culture, today also Culture and Education, Divine Worship and Discipline of the Sacraments, Laity, Family and Life, Council for the Economy, and also members of C9. We also have with us His Excellency Pietro Carlos Cipollini, Bishop of Sant'Andre in Sao Paulo since 2015. He's Brazilian. He was born in Caconde in the Diocese of São João da Boa Vista. He was ordained in 1978, and within the framework of the Brazilian Episcopal Conference, he was appointed member of the Pastoral Episcopal Commission for the Doctrine of the Faith and president of the same commission since 2019 to the present day, 2024. We also have with us Mrs. Dr. Sheila Pires, Secretary of the Commission for Information, and Dr. Paolo Ruffini, who is the commission's president. So, Dr. Ruffini, the floor is yours. Actually, no. First, we give the floor to Sheila. Thank you. Good morning. So today I will be speaking in Portuguese. So there were 346 members in today's meeting, and the free interventions continued on theme 2. And two themes were highlighted. The first, how to reconfigure participation from a missionary perspective within the context of a change of epoch in the face of the phenomena of human mobility in the culture of the digital environment. So what are we called to give up, and what are the obstacles, and what to promote? The second theme was related to synodality as collegiality and primacy, the role of the Roman Curia, in light of Praedicat Evangelium, the Universal Synod, Ecclesial Continental Assemblies, and also synods, particular synods and particular councils. Many presentation or speeches talked about the difficulties met by migrants. Gratitude was expressed for what the churches do in order to welcome these persons. In the future, it was proposed to create an ecclesial assembly for the Mediterranean area, not a Euro-Mediterranean, but in order to be able to listen directly to the voices of these people. And what was also highlighted was the importance of the work carried out by the churches in the Mediterranean basin, which started creating structures that make up a network. Another topic was that of making sure that parishes meet the needs of young people, perhaps changing the time of the Mass, and also opening chapels in shopping centers, etc. The small communities should be present where people live, and they are the best placed in identifying a journey. Without the reconfiguration of parishes and networks or small communities, synodality becomes slower and runs the risk of becoming a centralizing element. Also, virtual networks were mentioned, such as Telita Cum, which are supported by women, men and women religious, and those who participate in them come from different cultures and exchange gifts, the one with the others. And we asked ourselves how to connect these to the networks, the parishes and the episcopal conferences. Another topic was that of persons with disabilities. Recalling that Jesus himself would identified with these persons, getting close to them with words of integral liberation, but nothing in any way remotely related to resignation or paternalism. So Jesus placed them at the center of the world as members on an equal footing with the others. The Synodal Church must feel the need to bear in mind and to take into consideration the persons with disabilities. And the proposal was made to create a council for disabilities. It was also remembered that the first apostolic recommendation is do not forget the poor. And it was said that we must shake the consciences of Catholics in the world of the economy, of economics and the institutions. What was also proposed is a platform, a common platform for the students of different religions who attend Catholic schools. And we tried to reflect on how to root in the local churches the synodal experience, in other words, freedom to speak to each other without being afraid. It was also said that the church needs to inhabit windy places where the spirit blows without taking refuge in safe places. There is a sentence from the Instrumentum Laboris saying God continues to talk through the events that take place in space and time, and the places of synodality cannot be protected homes, nor can they be just institutional ones, but the crossroads where you discover something important. If the gospel meets the pressing needs of the place, different answers emerge for different cultures. Now I would like to give the floor to Mr. Ruffini. Thank you. What was also highlighted is the importance of the mission of men and women religious for their service and also for the places where they provide and give this service in promoting communion. Very often places where there is great suffering, difficulties, etc. Another topic was the importance of the relationship between synodality and primacy, highlighting the importance and the contribution of the Oriental churches, the Eastern churches, and the importance of dialogue between the Catholics and the Orthodox, quoting the contributions that emerge from the theological forums. And it was also said that it is not a matter of attributing to the Episcopal Conference the competence or the capacity of defining new dogmas or professing specific articles of faith, but rather teaching authentically the only faith of the Church in an enculturated way within a specific context as an answer to the particular questions and challenges among the people, and that this authentic teaching takes place in communion with the entire Church, and that the doctrinal authority must therefore be combined with the pastoral authority, and every reflection on this should also consider the hierarchy of truths. And then What was also underscored was the value of the local churches that also the nuncios should recognize. It was remembered that there is no church without the bishop, and there is no bishop without the church, and that this is also very important from the ecumenical perspective, and that the apostolic succession is also related to 1C. We said also that we must not be afraid of synodality, not promoting polarization that jeopardizes unity around Peter, and so it jeopardizes the unity of the church. But on the contrary, unity should be promoted in the several contexts that concreteness is required. And what is surprising is that so many years after the council, the theological statute of episcopal conferences has not been entirely clarified. Also, another important thing was that of consulting the local churches when the documents are being prepared. On the part of the Roman Curia, there should be a constant consultation of the local churches. It was also said that the Pope always needs the help of the faithful, and that the mission of the entire people of God consists in helping the Pope. So somehow we should also revisit the Synod of the Bishops, and bishops should consult the entire people of God to then provide themselves advice to the Pope and to the other bishops through the episcopal conferences. It was also highlighted that we need a greater trust, and that we need to change the way in which Rome and the local bishops communicate, and those who work in the Roman dicasteries should go and visit more often the small communities and the dioceses. It was also said that the universal church becomes alive in the particular churches. In the document, it was required to give space to the central role of the Eucharist, because the synodal church receives the forms of communion from Jesus Christ and from His Spirit. Otherwise, it runs the risk of becoming self-referential. From the viewpoint of useful information, but you are being handed over the necessary information, let me remind you that tomorrow afternoon there's going to be a live event during which Cardinal Grech and Cardinal Olerich, Sister Letizia Salazar and Bishop Daniel Flores will answer the questions of some university students. It is going to be live streamed, but if you wish, you may accredit yourself. Thank you. Thank you for all this information, and I would like to now give the floor to Sister Samuela Maria Rigon. The sister is a peer of a congregation that is present in many parts of the world, and the universality experience of the Church made in the Synod is much broader. I would say it's an opening to get to know realities that are very different, particularly non-European ones and not belonging to the Western world. Good afternoon to everybody. I was said that we can speak for 3 minutes, so I decided to share with you a couple of things, and then, of course, if there are questions, we can address other topics. One of the experiences that has struck me more strongly since last year, but this year too, is precisely the experience of the universality of the Church. And it is an experience that I have in my own congregation and that I have made in my consecrated life. But here we can truly get in touch with realities of the world that nobody speaks about. And this makes us understand that the Church is much broader than the institutional Church or what we know here in Rome or in the European context. And I think that this is a very significant aspect in the Synod. And also, universality also has another side, which is that of being able to get in touch with vocations, functions, and roles that are different within the Church. In the Synod of Bishops, 75% of participants are bishops, but there are also so many other people who participate in it, such as priests, lay persons, consecrated men and women from different realities. And this is too an expression of the universality of the Church. And all have the same opportunity of contributing to the discussion and talking. And this, I think, is quite beyond the results that we could expect without such a synod. So the synod is per se a great step in the journey of the church, of course, there are tensions and we hold different positions. We see reality in different ways, the way we understand it, and also the themes that we are discussing are all different. But then I don't think we're talking about polarization, but actually the polarities, different polarities to inhabit, including that of the universality of the church. So a sort of a decentralization process, which is necessary to delve deeper into the cultures of every place and every reality. And at the same time, there is the unity of the church, which is strongly manifested. So we live many polarities, and we perhaps are not used to inhabit these polarities, including that man versus woman. Another aspect I would like to share with you is that the synod brings us back to the centrality of relations. Synodality is, first of all, relational. And I think that it is really going back to the sources, to the roots of the church, because Jesus built relationships. He spoke directly, personally with people. So going back to our roots, to the origin, is very important. And renewal is starting. It requires starting from this. So our brothers and sisters having a relationship with them, there are conflicts that should be overcome. It doesn't mean that we are able to do so, but we must establish first of all a relationship with Jesus, then amongst ourselves in our realities, and among the different cultures and the different particular churches, and so on and so forth. And another aspect, the last aspect I would like to share with you, for me, is truly the renewal of the church. History constantly changes, so we are truly called upon to read events in light of the Word of God, to understand where the Spirit is blowing. And Jesus went towards, he reached out to people. So for a long time we have been suffering for this, because people do not come to the churches anymore, but it's us Christians who must reach out to them, to go where they are, where they live, where they suffer. So there are many good experiences in this connection. Thank you. Thank you, sister. And so reaching out, tensions, movement, a church on the move, just like Jesus did, who reached out to people. So I would like now to go further and give the floor to Cardinal Bo, who is president of the Asian Bishops' Conferences. Your Eminence, can you tell us something about the relationship between the AFABC and the Synod?
I'd like to speak on the connection between the synodal journey and the effects in Asia. When the Federation of Asia Bishop Conferences, FABC, was in the midst of preparing FABC 50, Pope Francis announced the synodal journey from 21 to 23 and later extending to 24. The year 2020 marked the 50th anniversary of FABC. To observe this landmark, we intended to together in a general conference to commemorate and to chart the direction of the coming years. Since we are already in the preparation phase, the synodal process and the FABC journey could proceed in one after another, together integrated, as it was already the intention of FABC to bring renewal to the churches in Asia. It converged with the direction of Pope Francis, was inviting the church to move forward. So based on the reports of FABC received in response from the bishop conferences, we have the effects of synodality. One is the increased awareness of the Holy Spirit role. The method of conversation in spirit has trained individuals and as well as communities. Then the baptismal dignity and charism. There is a growing recognition of the role of all baptized members in the church, including their involvement in decision-making and ministry. Youth engagement. The process has fostered a greater inclusion of young people, particularly in digital evangelization in ministries. Innovation in ministry. Synodality has encouraged creativity in pastoral work. Then addressing clericalism. A synodal approach has helped confront clericalism, promoting co-responsibility, transparency among clergy and laity. Of course, we have that encounter challenges. One is the cultural diversity. Asia's deep-rooted cultures and traditions pose challenges for synodality, with its changes sometimes perceived as foreign or disruptive. To lack of clarity, there remains confusion about the concept of synodality, partly due to the linguistic challenges in translating the term and communicating its essence. Three is the resource limitation. There is a need for more trained facilitators and resources to carry out a synodal formation. Four is the distance and geography. Asia's vastness presents logistical challenges, making in-person meetings difficult and costly. Five is the resistance to change. Some clergy and bishops feel threatened by the participatory nature of synodality, fearing a loss of authority, income, or privilege. Cultural obstacle for women. In many patriarchal societies, it is challenging for women to take leadership in roles of the church. We have to go against the current of the Buddhism or Islamism. So the things that we could give attention was the women, the youth, the poor and marginalized, and the migrants. So the synodal changes became a synodal church requiring renewal existing structure such as seminarians and parish organizations. The role of FABC plays a critical role in guiding the church in Asia towards a synodal mission. It serves as a platform for collaboration among local churches and promotes shared pastoral priorities. In conclusion, the FABC concludes by recognizing that while challenges remain, the synthesis report had provided in the last year a valuable opportunity for the church in Asia to reflect on its journey towards becoming a synodal church on mission. The process has brought renewed energy and hope for the future, and the church in Asia is committed to building a church that includes everyone and listens to everyone. The FABC remains optimistic about the second session of the Synod of Bishops in 2024, seeing it as another important step in the global synodal journey. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Your Eminence. You talked about the topic of clericalism, a challenge that was often addressed by Pope Francis in his speeches. We will continue by giving the floor to another Cardinal, Cyprien Lacroix, Archbishop of Quebec, and Your Eminence. So the Synod, in your opinion, was a chaos this particular time when we need so much listening. So how are you experiencing this period, this opportunity for listening? Thank you so much and good morning. I will be speaking in French with a strong Quebecois accent. So we are now at the third year of the Synod, the Synod on Synodality, and this is the third week. I think that the Lord was waiting for us. This synodal experience is important because the world today needs to listen. And the process we are experiencing, which started in October 2021, concerns the entire church. And the church as a whole was placed in a position of listening. First of all, listening to the word of God, listening to the others. And perhaps it was precisely this part that we are to discover yet, listening to the others. So listening not just to each other within the church, within our institutions, but also listening to the entire population, all our brothers and sisters, and the reality of the world. And this is essential. After 3 years of journey, of this process, many activities. What I see is that this experience is preparing us to be men and women capable of listening to the others, those who think differently from us and who are different from us. So we are making an experience of synodality that shows us that, yes, it is possible. And if we continue as a church, as a people of God, to work this way, well, I think that we will give the world a witness, the witness that it is possible to listen, to discern to make good choices. We see what happens in the world today. This is quite evident. There is such a lack of listening. Just weapons and bombings are resorted to, thinking that this may solve problems, while you create many more. So, as it was said earlier, we are about 350 people who, for 3 weeks, have been together, and there have not been, you know, crises. We did not beat each other up because we were capable of listening to each other, to discover the reality of the other. And I think this is a very good experience in many respects. And if we can live this here, but not just here, and also in our particular churches, in our environments, in our communities, ecclesial communities, well, then we will be able to discern and to consider all the great issues that affect the world today. In English, we call them hot issues. Well, there are themes that truly need to be deepened, to be, for us to be true believers, but also to be credible. So how can we do this? Well, through synodality. In our church, there are people who are so well prepared, so intelligent, clever, with great experience. So we do have persons like this. We do have many people capable of reflecting, but we needed to learn and to sit down together, but not as an enterprise, a firm, but as a community of disciples of Jesus, to listen together to what God is telling us, so as to be all able to benefit from this. So the great gift of the Synod, and we increasingly discover this, is the conversation in the Spirit, which unites us and allows us to sit together around all these tables where all these exchanges take place, contributions from representatives of different continents or religious traditions. So they are all listening to God. They are all listening to the others. And we are already reaping the fruits of this. So what we look for, and it's not like in a business or an enterprise, we're not looking for excellence, we're looking for holiness. We're not looking for output results such as you would have in a firm with statistical data, etc. What we are looking for is the fruit of the kingdom of God. And I think that we are on the right way. I hold great hopes despite the many challenges before us. And we need to continue discerning, addressing all these great issues and topics and themes, and we are truly learning to listen to each other and to listen to the Lord together. So it's God who is faithful and accompanies the people in their journey. And this is something that we were able to see throughout the entire history of salvation. And I am walking, journeying with the people of God. I'm also following suit, because together we look for the journey and the pathway for our future. Thank you. Thank you. Listening seems to be the most important tool, weapon in a sense, much more powerful than bombs and missiles that unfortunately are being resorted to in our time. Our host from Brazil, our guest from Brazil, Monsignor Cipollini. So we talked about conversion, structural pastoral conversion, and you were saying that that there will never be a pastoral conversion unless there is a spiritual conversion, which is the most important one, because there is something which is more important than anything else. Good morning to everybody. I will not repeat what has already been said here, summarizing today's work in the Synodal Hall. I don't think it's neither necessary to speak about universality as an experience, diversity, etc. But I will talk about a transverse, a cross-sectional theme. which is present in everything we talk about at the Synod, which is the topic of changes, so necessary changes based on everything that was addressed in the Synod. So something has changed, and something has to change. And the word change in ecclesial and biblical language is translated into conversion. This is present in the Gospel, particularly in what Jesus says and what he asks for from those who listen to him. So the first thing he says is convert yourself. And the Synod requires a change, so a conversion. I think in three directions. So first of all, a pastoral and synodal conversion, changing our pastoral action conducted by the church, the way in which we carry out our mission, the way in which we evangelize, the way in which we evangelize in the mass media, and expanding the places of evangelization. So the territory alone today is not sufficient, because there are other places that must be evangelized. Another point of conversion would be the structural conversion, and this is a great challenge. So changing our structures with the kingdom of God as our reference horizon. So not just the church ad intra. The third point of conversion would be the spiritual and synodal conversion, in the sense of looking at our roots. There's a comparison between the church and a tree. Well, in this case, the spirituality is the sap that keeps the tree up, alive and blooming. So there is this encounter with the passion of Jesus. Jesus is our reference point, and Jesus is the starting and end point. The word of God, the personal witness of our lives, the words, and we do have many words in today's church. Well, all these can be convincing, but then it's the witness that really attracts people towards. So conversion is not simply a rational process, but it's also very much emotional. We have a rational and an emotional intelligence. So when we talk about conversion and change from a rational perspective, well, there is no confusion. But then when we talk about emotions, there things change, are different. So we need to welcome what is new, the new things that the Holy Spirit points us at and that has been pointing to throughout the whole Synod. Thank you. We now will pass the floor over to our friend journalists. So also from the forums that were held yesterday, what has emerged, it seems, that one of the themes that has come up at the Synod is that of the relationship between the universal and the particular churches, and the power, in inverted commas, maybe this is not the right word, but anyway, the power of the local churches versus Rome. For instance, yesterday we heard that a ministry of listening is being talked about at the Synod. And what is also being proposed is that this ministry of listening is decided and established not so much by Rome, but by the particular churches. And today, Mr. Ruffini talked about the debate that there has been, I'm not sure in what terms, but on the relationship between authority, local authority, and the Roman authority, so the doctrinal and non-doctrinal authority, guarantee on the faith, the truths of faith. I think this is one of the themes that attracts a certain amount of debate. Some people want this and some people want that. Can you tell us something more about it? So since I was, my name was mentioned, I will say that this is the theme of the Instrumentum Laboris that we are discussing. This is nothing new, and I'm sure that you and our colleagues all know that this finds its origin in the Council, the Second Vatican Council, Paul VI, etc. So there have been contributions or interventions that talked about this theme. As to the ministries and the rest and so on and so forth, yes, we are still discussing the forms that they should take, so we must still wait for something more concrete, because then the reports of the working groups have not yet been handed in, and there is still a discussion that has to take place. So we are still at a stage whereby we are still having this conversation in the spirit. There are many pauses, reflection, prayer, and this is just to give you an idea of the way in which we are proceeding. So some spoke about ministry of listening, some others spoke about the service of listening, others has talked about this ministry as an established ministry, others talked about how to make this concrete versus the sacrament of confession. Of course, we are talking about totally different things here, and the entire church as a listening church. And if this were a ministry, if this is a ministry that was to be established, it doesn't mean that the others don't listen. So it's a way of talking about the church that in some way that is made up by the people of God, that is united by the baptismal priesthood, that is something that we all share. And then, of course, there are charisms, ministries, ordained ministries, non-ordained ministries. So we are discussing this in these terms, and we are trying to share with you these things just to make you understand the type of conversation which is occurring. But undoubtedly, the other guests may add something to my words. Well, I can say something in this connection. I think that perhaps we should also update our language in a sense, because when we speak about doctrine, it is the right language. But then we must also think about what makes us Christians and that makes us one. So having the same doctrine, being sure that reassured that we all believe in the same Christ, one and triune, this is what allows us to be one. Then, of course, we must adapt languages and pastoral care ministry to the reality in which we live. But I think that this is an attention that the church has. The church only exists in history and to evangelize. So this is a tension that has to be there all the time. As to the ministries, not all ministries must be established or instituted. So if we need a ministry for listening, then perhaps it means that we do not listen sufficiently. So this is something that should make us think. Thank you. Let us now move on to another question. Perhaps Franco Ferrari, Missione Oggi. I have a set of questions, actually, and I'll be quick. The first is addressed to Cardinal Delacroix and Cardinal Beau, and it concerns these two aspects. In the Instrumentum Laboris at number 91, we read that in the most promising contexts in which to act for a quick implementation of the synodal orientations that may lead to changes that can be rapidly perceived, so the collegial bodies would be entrusted with this, and so they should also be made mandatory in expressing their orientations. The other element is related to the topic of episcopal conferences and their power. In number 97, we read the document proposes that there should be an announcement of the episcopal conferences concerning liturgical and disciplinary theological spiritual issues appropriate for the different sociocultural contexts. So the question is, what type of opinions have been exchanged or are being exchanged in this module within the assembly, and towards what type of consensus are we going? Another question is addressed to Monsignor Cipollini. The fil rouge in almost all the interventions of those who have come here to this press conference room is to say that we need time to reflect, to come to decisions. Now, the problem seems to me to be that there is a separation mismatch between the time of society and the time that the church wishes to take to answer the issues that have been raised, the problems that have been raised, and that were also emerged from the great consultation of the people of God. In connection with many of these problems, it's not so much necessary to carry out further deepenings, which, given the results of the studies, and I'm thinking about women's diaconate, would not produce shocking breakthroughs. Well, rather the problem is that of reaching consensus rapidly, and if this is not achieved for this matter as well as others, probably there should be the courage of making some decision. The last question is addressed, and I apologize for being so long. The other question is addressed to Mr. Ruffini concerning two questions or two issues. You talked about the live intervention tomorrow afternoon with Cardinal Grech, where this is going to be held. And the other issue, if I remember correctly, tomorrow afternoon there should also be an exchange or a meeting between the assembly and the study groups. So how is this meeting organized, and if it's open, or if we can follow it in some way? I will answer first, so I will allow the other guests to remember all your questions. So the live event is in the Synod Hall, and it can be followed. You can follow the intervention from the balconade. The other meetings are held simultaneously. There are many, and they are not open to the public. These are moments when tomorrow afternoon the individual groups, I can tell you about mine because I'm in the group on the mission in the digital environment. So the groups will meet with those who wish to tell the group members about the reflections. So it's a moment of listening between the groups and the members and the synod members who want to talk about the themes addressed within the groups. So because there are many groups, some are in the rooms attached to the Paul VI hall, other rooms are outside because otherwise there wasn't enough space, because in some groups, 80 synodal members requested to talk to them, and some others, same thing. In other words, we needed much space. So this is going to be taking place between 3:30 to 7 p.m. So some of these groups will also be meeting at the same time as the live event, but they will meet in different places. Thank you, Mr. Ruffini. So if I understood well, the first questions concerned number 91 and 97 of the Instrumentum Laboris on the collegial bodies and the announcement of the episcopal conferences concerning liturgical, theological, spiritual issues. So the opinions, if there has been an exchange of opinions within the hall. Thank you. So the question you were asking, of course, is something that leads to tensions, and this is a good thing. I do experience an important tension. First of all, there is a pressure of my bloodstream, which is important, otherwise I would be dead. But this is something that makes us alive. So this tension, this sort of pressure makes us alive. These questions you asked are there, and we are starting to consider how to respond to them. But to do this, you need an attitude of inner opening. So you have to be open to what the others say, and the others must be ready to listen to me to be able to try and find a response together, whether this takes place at the local level or not. For instance, we could say it's mandatory to have a pastoral council or a parish council, but if you organize meetings when nobody is listening, this is quite pointless. So we must decide together to listen to what God is telling us, a small ecclesial community or a parish or a diocese. If we decide together to listen, then we can find something. Within our diocese, we have started carrying out the conversation in the spirit at the parish level, at the level of the presbyteral council. And this changes the way in which we are together. One of the things that we must renew when we go back home is undoubtedly how to live in a synodal spirit, the diocesan council. So now, how can we find, and how can there be autonomy between the episcopal conferences and the dicasteries? Well, there are already some opportunities in the liturgy. The dicastery for divine worship leaves more room to episcopal conferences concerning language and enculturation aspects relating to the liturgy. This is a small example, but then there are many others. And there is also, of course, a long way to go, but then if we listen to each other and if we look for a solution together, we will find it. So as the bishop from Brazil said, this requires a true conversion, a deep conversion. So it's not just a debate where we exchange ideas. We must really and truly listen. There was a question on the topic of the time needed to reflect and decide. Of course, there is a time for deciding, a time for reflecting, and often, of course, there is a gap between this and the time that runs in everyday life. Cardinal Martini, I remember, may participated in this famous interview, and he said that there are many years of delay in decision making concerning certain aspects on the part of the Church. So, how can we get to consensus for the Church? Consensus is very important. Sometimes, though, it takes time because the Church is a complex organism. It's not just a human organism. It's both human and divine. The Church exists because this is God's will. And human beings are a part of the Church. So that's why sometimes ideas take time to ripen. The challenge for the Church is not to meet all requests, meet all needs, and be in agreement with the entire world. The challenge for the Church is fidelity to the Holy Spirit, to what the Spirit points out to us throughout history. And this is the challenge of discernment. And that is why we are here convened in a synod, to discern what is going to happen. So we don't know about the future. We just have to wait for an outcome. Thank you. Your Eminence, would you like to add something? No.
Concerning the first question, more or less, as I understood it, I'd like to say a word on the communication and connection between the different dicasteries and bishop conferences and the diocese. You know, I have been, this is my eighth synod, and I'm as a bishop for 34 years and as a priest 49 years already. When I was made bishop in 1990, one thing that attracted me in the canon law is that about the diocesan synod. So in my all these years as a bishop, I have been in seven dioceses, and I have conducted the diocesan synod for four times, 1991, 1996, 2004, and 2014. Even this synodality and synod before that, even I had a very simple way of conducting the diocesan synod, getting the feedbacks from the farmers, from the villages, from the parishes, from workers and religious, priests and us. So we tried to discuss that all their reports. And on that one, we try to build a vision, a mission for the and for the diocese. So what I would like to express is that this in the past synods, and normally in the past, what we are feeling after the synod, there would the Pope would issue an exaltation, and the most of the exaltation would go to the library and everything finished. But this synod is very special one. It is a process. It is the life of the church. It's an integral in our church. So I wish it also to encourage all the bishops and all the dioceses, after this synod, when we go back home, then each diocese should really celebrate or conduct a diocesan synod basing on the fruits that we gather in this synod in synodality, that we don't stop just with this meeting, but it's a continuous effort that we try in all the churches and all. Thank you.
Thank you. Andiamo da Davis, per favore.
Davis, please.
Davis from America Magazine, and I was never a good theology student, so I apologize if this is a bit imprecise. But talking about allowing for the teaching of the only faith, but in an enculturated context, I wonder at the level of if we're granting some kind of teaching authority, official teaching authority to bishops' conferences, even at the level of discipline. So say you may have some bishops in the United States that may want to ease some of the restrictions on the Latin Mass, or the bishops in Brazil may want to ordain married men, the viri probati, or in Germany, the bishops may want to allow for a way to allow women to preach in certain instances. Would this be an appropriate expression of enculturated teaching? And if so, do you think the body of the synod would confirm something like that, or do you think there would still be broad resistance? Thank you.
Grazie. Grazie, Davis. Sentiamo la risposta.
Thank you. Yeah, I don't know, Your Eminence says, who would like to respond?
I'm very much consoled that you are not a theologian. I too am not a theologian. I never studied in Rome. That's why my Italian is very, very poor. But what you have talked is, I think the Pope did not conclude all those topics in this synod, but he has put aside 10 groups which is still in the continuity of our special studies, which they are still discussing. And I believe that by 2025, that the reports and all will come out, I believe.
Benissimo.
Very good. I would like to add something, and this is just to give an answer to what was asked by Ambrogetti. These afternoon themes are the criteria for decentralization, church of churches, exchange of gifts, subsidiarity, etc. We are just discussing. You cannot ask those who are sitting at this table to decide or to tell you about a decision that has not been made yet. This is just a discussion, an exchange, as I said earlier. So this is not something that even comes out of the Instrumentum Laboris. So there is Argentes, Lumen Gentium. You can find so many quotations concerning this theme. So it doesn't mean that you can ask me or somebody else what the final document is going to look like. You have to realize that we are simply telling you about our discernment in the spirit, a conversation in the spirit. And then, of course, there will be further steps in with the approval of the final document, who will be handed to the Pope. So you know this much, you know this well. I mean, you know, you've known this process and you've known it longer than I've been a part of it. Thank you. Danubia, and then we end for today, and we will be back tomorrow. So my question is for Father Pedro. His Excellency talked about changes, pastoral and structural conversion, spiritual conversion. So where are we at this synod? And what is the journey, in your opinion, so that conversion takes place and is achieved? Thank you for your question. I think that the very existence of the synod, the fact that we are together, that we patiently listen to each other, is a great moment of conversion, within which we listen to civil society and we listen to the church. Sometimes we tend not to listen. We are a society where everybody has got something to say and we all talk, but nobody wants to listen. So I think that there is already a conversion that takes place thanks to a respectful and a careful listening, which is what we have experienced in the synodal hall. So priests, lay persons, they share with us their witnesses and we listen. This conversion is a bit slow because it's not a mathematical thing. It's not something which is automatic. It is related to personal freedom. It is a dialogue between God and personal freedom. So there is also the factor time, in inverted commas, which is required. And we are not so used to following this rhythm. We tend to act as machines rather than as human beings. So this conversion is complicated, but I think we are moving forward. And the existence of these two moments last year and this year in the two synodal sessions, this gives us hope. Hope that there is a conversion or change process, if you wish, which is ongoing. And we don't have a way of assessing results because we do not hold any power over the future. We cannot decide what the future is going to bring. But I'm very hopeful. And we are journeying, we are walking. And I think that the word hope is very much part of the conversion process. Thank you for your question. I will not be long because it's already been said that the conversion is ongoing. Between October last year and the present day, there have been many forums and spaces for this type of conversion, and perhaps also through online conferences and meetings in persons, and various dioceses are already experiencing synodality. So this conversion in listening, in living out synodality, is already something that is taking place in several conferences. And what we are experiencing here today too, this has been shared by other conferences that shared with us the work they carried out since last October to today. So little by little, we are moving forward in some spaces or areas. There are also some resistances, but synodality is lived out. Eminence, Your Eminence Lacroix, the floor is yours. I cannot answer and tell you where my brothers and sisters are, mothers and fathers of the Synod in the conversion process, but I can tell you where I stand, and I think I've moved forward. I've progressed. This process, this entire experience, sort of deepened something in ourselves where God can find something new. So I will leave this Synod with something new. I'm not going to be the same person as before, because the fact that I've listened to the others has allowed me to challenge myself, has changed me. And some convictions will remain, of course, but I also have now another way of seeing things. And I have truly listened, not just to find answers, but or to respond to others, but for me, for all of us who are experiencing the synod, it's something that it's quite new for us, and we are not used to living in such a synod. I participated in half the synods of Cardinal Bo, just four, but we were used to getting there with a pre-prepared document, with a sheet of paper saying, well, I want to say this, this, and that. What I'm saying is very important. No, not in this synod. We get to this synod with our ears that are open as well as our hearts, and not with with written down papers. Of course, we listen to what the others say, and we try to find a path together. And it is in this sense that I feel being challenged and I become more humble. And this is how we can listen together. The spirit, this is what my hope for the church is. So thank you, everybody. Cardinal Bo, Cardinal Lacroix, Father Pedro Cipollini, Reverend Mother Rigon. And so thank you, everybody, and see you again tomorrow. Thank you to Dr. Sheila Pires and Dr. Ruffini and to all those who worked with us today. Thank you.